So please draw this experiment one. You have a frame like this. A frame like this. This length is L. This is L. And this is a fill. Do you know what is a fill? Okay. Now, you are moving this link with, let us say, force F. Force F is very, very small, which lets this link move with almost zero velocity. Extremely slowly you are moving. Okay? So, there will be an opposite force also because of the fill. Yes or no? And perpendicular to this length. Alright? So, this force, what it does is, it moves by a distance of D. Okay? Now, I want you to apply work energy theorem between the initial and the final condition. Let's say surface tension is S. Work energy theorem between when piston is here and then when it is here. It has moved slowly. Use the first definition. What is work energy theorem? Work done is change in potential energy plus change in. Now, change in kinetic energy has no meaning here. So, this is zero. The mass of the film is almost zero. And anyway, it is not moving. Okay? So, whatever work is done increases the energy of the film. Now, can you write down? What is the work done on the film? How much is the work done on the film? F into D is kya sochna kya hai isme? Force into displacement is the work done. So work done on the film is F into D. This is equal to change in potential energy. Surface tension is surface energy per unit area. So multiply with area you get energy. Write down U2 minus U1. Written? This is work energy theorem. The work energy theorem first comes. Even mg, this force is there, right? But it takes care of potential energy. That is only the energy is. See, surface tension, you can either take it as energy or as a force. Just like gravity, you can take it as potential energy or as a force. You can't take it both ways. So final potential energy minus initial potential energy. So F into D. Final potential energy is how much? Surface tension into? L into? L into D plus this. Let us say that is X. Don't know what it is. This. Surface tension into area. Is this clear? This minus U1 is how much? S into L into X. So F into D is equal to what? S L into D. So S is equal to F by now tell me what is wrong here. Something is wrong. There is no calculation error. Some concept is wrong. No one? No one? How many surfaces are there? Two surfaces. One above, one below. Okay? So this film has two surfaces. So surface energy will be 2 times. Okay? So surface tension into 2. So there will be factor of 2. two surfaces are there, right? Above surface, it is a fin. Above and below. So this is one of those experiments. If you conduct, you will be able to find out the surface tension. Any doubt? No doubt. Now we are going to discuss the next experiment. Let's stop. Is this clear? Any doubt? No doubt? Alright, please move on to the next one. Experiment 2. Focus here. You have a bucket of water. Onto which a plate is dipped, a plate length is held. That plate is connected with a weighing scale like this. This plate is balanced right now. Everything is balanced. If I put little bit, this plate is kept like this. And if I place a mass M over here, then it is balanced. Are you getting it? If I place a mass M over there, now this will become horizontal. Things are balanced now. Okay? If I put little bit more mass here, it starts coming out. Now tell me why I have to place mass over here. If this water would not have been there, then you don't need mass to balance it. But now you're putting in water, if mass is there, you need extra mass over there. Point force is almost zero because thickness is negligible, it's a plate. Volume is almost zero. And buoyant force, even if it is there, will act upwards. You need to place weight because surface tension is pulling it down. Why surface tension is pulling it down? When if it is trying to come out, it is stretching the surface upwards. Are you getting what I am trying to say? When it is coming out, it is stretching the surface will be like this. Right now it is like this, when it is coming out, surface will become like that. So it stretches the surface. The object is here, the object comes out, the fluid surface will stretch with the surface and it will come with the object like that. Getting it? The surface area is increasing now. When it gets stretched, surface area increases. So because of that, surface tension will try to pull it back. It is like you are pulling the surface of the balloon up. So balloon will resist that. Same thing here. Okay? So because of surface tension it happens, let's say surface tension is S. Okay? Now use the second definition to find out what is the surface tension. Mass M is kept to balance the force of surface tension. Mg by? That is wrong. How many? So see, I have demonstrated also. The water surface will get pulled by this, pulled from this side as well as from this side. So two sides it get pulled. So surface tension force will be from two sides. Okay? So if you draw the free body diagram, this will be equal to Mg because Mg is the extra force over here. And surface tension force will be S into L and S into L down. What? Angle of contact is always zero. It is vertical like this. It will not be like that, right? It will be in contact with the solid. Solid is vertical. Okay? Force will pull it tangentially. Okay, so 2SL force should be equal to Mg. So S will be equal to Mg by 2L. So Mg I can take weight W. So W by 2L is the surface tension. Okay, so we have discussed two experiments. Experiment number one takes the first definition. to find out what is the surface tension. And experiment number 2 takes the second definition to find out the value of surface tension. Any doubt? No doubt? Good afternoon.
Huh?
See, the pan is placed such that everything was balanced, I mean, in here earlier. The mass, see, mass of this plate we are ignoring, because the pan was balancing the mass of the plate earlier. Whatever you are placing now is balancing the force due to surface tension only. That is the assumption. And that you can do experimentally. You can design an experiment such that it is taken care of. Or if it is not taken care of, you can put some mass already to balance that and then put the additional mass. This is the additional mass that is kept. Okay? Fine. Alright, so please write down. Drops and bubbles. Hey, break is over, okay? Break is done, accepted. We are talking about drops and bubbles now. Why drops are the way they are, and why they are spherical in shape, and why just keep quiet. When I'm saying something, you don't do all that. Okay. All right. So we are talking about drops and bubbles now. Bubble is exactly like balloon. Right? It has a membrane inside which there is an air. Okay? So, we are going to study drops and bubbles. Technically, we will study how it is and what is the pressure inside and how much pressure will result to which size of the drop and so on and so forth. Okay? So, the reason why bubbles and drops exist is because of the surface tension. Okay? So, let us try to analyze it. First, tell me, what is the difference between drop and a bubble? Drop, bubble is hollow. Okay, so if there is air inside liquid, is it a drop or a bubble? It is drop. It is a drop. Okay, so the technical definition of drop is, it should have only one interface. Please write down. Drop has one surface or one interface. Whereas a bubble has two interfaces or surface. Now you realize that air trapped inside liquid is air drop. But people say that it is a bubble, when the air bubble is inside water. No, it is not a bubble. Technically, it is a drop because it has only one interface between air and liquid. That's it. Okay. Whereas that toy you have seen, where the kids they blow bubble out of the soap solution. Okay, that is bubble because it has two interfaces. Inside that spherical shape is air, then this is the bubble, this is air, then this is liquid, and there is air again. So first surface is inside, other surface is outside. Two surfaces. Okay? A drop has only one surface. Okay? That you need to understand. That technically, you have written right? Technically, the bubble has two interfaces and the drop has only one interface. Now, this is, let us say, a drop of water. It's a drop of water. Surface tension is, let's say, S. Inner pressure is P-I-N or just write PI. And outer pressure is PO. Okay? Now assume that this drop has expanded slightly. It is just an assumption. Suppose the radius was R and very very small expansion, let's say delta R expansion has happened. Okay? Any doubt? Now please apply work energy theorem during before the expansion, after the expansion. The expansion is so less that inner pressure remains unchanged. If you have more amount of expansion, the inner pressure will change. Apply work energy theorem. No velocity, negligible, and the drop is not moving at all. In short, changing kinetic energy is zero. What are the forces acting on the drop? P1 and P2, two pressures are there, they will do the work, right? The force is pressure into area, surface area. Should I do it? Work done by the inner pressure is how much? Pi into 4 pi r square. This is force. Force into what? Delta r. This is work done by the inner pressure. And work done by outer pressure is what? P outer into 4 pi r square into delta r. Something wrong. Delta R is very small, surface area is 4 pi r square approximately. But still there is something wrong.
Negative.
It is negative. Work done by outer is negative. It expands against the outside pressure force. So expansion is in opposite direction of that of the force. So total work done will be what? Sum of these two, which will be Pi minus PO 4 pi r square delta r. And change in energy is how much? How to write change in energy? Surface tension into the final surface area 4 pi r plus delta r whole square minus 4 pi r square. Now if I ignore delta r here, it will come out to be 0. So I am not ignoring it. Surface tension into final surface area is the energy finally. Surface tension into initial surface area is the energy initially. Surface tension is energy per unit area. Any doubt? Okay, now if you rearrange the term, you will get here as, it become r square plus 4 pi delta r square plus 8 pi r delta r minus 4 pi r square. Any doubt till now? Is it clear? So 4 pi r square and 4 pi r square gone, and delta r is very small. So delta r square is negligible compared to r into delta r. So even this I can ignore. Fine. So change in potential energy will come out to be 8 pi r delta r into s. So this should be equal to that according to work energy theorem. Alright, so Pi minus P naught into 4 pi r square delta r should be equal to 8 pi r delta r into s. So you can see that 4 pi and here 2 and 1 r is gone, delta r is also gone. So I am getting P I minus P naught is equal to 2S by R. Okay, so inside the drop pressure is more because the outer surface acts like a membrane, and if it is membrane, it actually wants to have almost zero size, and you are expanding it. It's like a balloon expanding. So if it expands, the inner pressure has to be more, and this is what it is. Inner pressure will be more than the outside pressure by a factor of 2s by r. Any doubt? Now, here is the thing. Till now, every time we dealt with a scenario in which a bucket is filled with water, outside pressure is, let's say, atmosphere. Just inside the surface also we have taken atmospheric pressure only. And then we have written P A plus rho G H. Yes or no? The pressure just outside the fluid was equal to pressure just inside. The first time I am telling you pressure just inside is more than pressure just outside. The reason is, first, surface tension, and second, the radius was infinite in this case. It was flat. So when this R is infinite, 2S by R becomes 0. Getting it? But if surface is curved, then pressure just outside is different from pressure just inside. You can't just say that outside atmospheric pressure, so just inside also atmospheric pressure, so that plus rho gh. No. That is true only when surface is horizontal or when surface tension is zero. Getting it? All of you? Alright? Now, this is for the drop. What do you think for the bubble? How will you do it? For the bubble, if you follow the same process, what is the only difference you will see? There are two surfaces. Two surfaces are there. So, the S will be multiplied by 2S. This will be 2S, so this will be 2S, S will be 2S, so for bubble, P I minus P naught will be 4S by R. This is for the bubble. This is for the drop. Okay, fine. Now if you have that same toy which kids play, as in they pour it on a soap solution, then blow air on it. If you blow the air very fast, the radius of the bubbles will be lesser or more? Why? The pressure inside the bubble will be more or less if you're blowing fast? Pressure will be more? Pressure will be more? Outside pressure is fixed, atmospheric pressure. So difference in pressure will be large. So R should be less. So if you want the bubble to have more radius, you should blow it slowly. Okay? Getting it? Right? But earlier we have discussed that if velocity is more, pressure decreases. But I am here, when I am taking this example, I am not assuming that the fluid is flowing continuously. Fluid is flowing, it has kinetic energy, half rho v square is there. As soon as it gets inside the bubble, kinetic energy is lost, it got converted into pressure energy. Getting it? So more is the kinetic energy, more will be the pressure energy. Half rho v square will be equal to P. Alright, so that is why if you blow with higher velocity, inside pressure will be more, difference in pressure will be more, and R of the bubble will be lesser. Okay?